shown us so much mercy. You have shown us so much mercy. You have saved me from the pit. Just declare what he saved you from right now for a moment. You saved me from the pit of drugs and alcohol you have. You lifted me up from fear and doubt and discouragement. Yes, you did. Yes, you did. You are so worthy, God. You are so worthy, God. You are so worthy, God. Oh, I feel that right now. You are so worthy, God. Sing it out. You are so worthy, God. You are so worthy, God. Hey. You are so worthy, God. Oh, you are so worthy, God. Oh, he's on that. Come on. You are so shown me grace. You lifted my shame. You draw me with loving kindness. Washed whiter than snow. You have redeemed and made me whole. Sing grace. Grace. You shown me grace. You've lifted my shame. You've drawn me with loving kindness. Washed whiter than snow. You have redeemed and made me whole. Sing, Jesus, you have won me. Jesus, you have won me. You've broken every chain with love and mercy. You triumphed over death, and you are worthy of glory and praise. Sing it out with me again. Jesus, you have won me. Jesus, you have won me. You've broken every chain with love and mercy. You triumphed over death, and you are worthy of glory and praise. Sing love. You show me love. Verse 2. Love. You've shown me love by leaving your throne, by bleeding and dying on a cross. That wonderful cross that took all my guilt and sin away. Sing love. Love, you show me love by leaving your throne, by bleeding and dying.
continue worship, but I want us to pray for someone that's having surgery right now as we speak. That's Peter and Beth's son. He's only in his 30s. Serious surgery. Named Daniel. Let's pray for a miracle. But also, how many need miracles this morning? You need something. It's bigger than you, but it's not bigger than God. And so let's just ask Him. Let's call on Him. His presence is so mighty. He's so awesome in this place. I have a way to know, for me personally, my eyes start leaking. And when I know He's in the room, and it dates way back, He's in the room. And we just honor Your presence, Lord. We honor You. We honor You, King Jesus. We lift up over these flags and we declare over the nations that Jesus Christ is Lord. He reigns and rules. He's sovereign. He's holy. He's the answer to every problem, every question. Lord, we thank You. You're ruling and you're breaking out all over the earth. And Lord, would You break out in a hospital room or actually in surgery right now in Maryland for Peter and Beth, their son. We pray for Daniel. It's a big thing, but You're a big God. And we just declare Your lordship and we break the power of that spirit of infirmity and every destruction over him. Lord, we pray that he would be rescued and saved and delivered, healed to serve You, that he would fulfill the purpose that he's been born for. And we declare that over everyone in this room. In the name of Jesus, we break off every assignment of darkness, every opinion of hell, every prognosis that's contrary, Lord, to the will of God. We declare Your lordship, Your kingship, and we loose the power of heaven. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Jesus. God, just touch people, even watching by web stream. We pray for miracles. Lord, stretch forth Your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders would be done through the holy name of Your servant Jesus. Right now, in nations, nations. Thank You, Lord. Lord, we just are honored. You're just amazing. You're amazing, God. So thank You in advance for taking care of Daniel, Lord. He shall live. In Jesus' name, he shall live. Thank You. Just go back into worship. This is an amazing time. You know, these are the moments we've been waiting for. The moments we want to live for. We are living for. It's in Him we live and move and make our being. Thank You, Lord.
Yeah, let's just bless His name. So we shout it out and do. Just tell him how much you need him right now. God, we need you so much. We need you every moment, every day, every time, at all times, God, we need your presence. Growing as a believer is growing in the fact that you need the Lord. That's part of it. And how much you need him every day. So, Lord, we humble ourselves to the fact that we need you so much, God. Sing it again, Lord, I come. Lord, I come and I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart, 'cause you're the one that guides my heart. Sing, Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Where grace is found, that's where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. And holiness is Christ in me. Stand, I'll fall on you. 'Cause Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Teach my song. Teach my song to rise to you when temptation comes. When temptation comes my way. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope. Jesus, you're my hope. Teach my song, yes. Teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way. Jesus.
Jesus, you're my hope instead.
Last 3 nights, I've opened up with a song. There's 5 songs that you'll hear on the DVD if you get it that came from prayer. But I want to sing a song I didn't write this morning. It's a song written by a man by the name of Matt Gillum from IHOP. And it's a song that's talking about the New Jerusalem. And it ties in with what I believe the Lord wants to share this morning. So if you could just close your eyes. You know, I don't think there's anything else other than worship that just connects souls and that just creates a irresistible atmosphere for unity. And so, yeah, I just want to sing this.
Said I'm longing for a city, not made by human hands. And I'm longing for the garden, where God once walked with man. For eternity is written on my heart. Said I am longing for the day that we will never be apart. When every tear will be wiped away. There'll be no sorrow, hurt, or pain. There'll be no more night. All things will be made new. It will be a brand new day. And in your righteousness you'll reign. And the Lamb will be the light. So behold, the tabernacle of God will be with men, and he will be our God, and we will be his people, and the bride, she will marry the Lamb. But until that day, I'm longing for the New Jerusalem. I looked and saw a city, yeah, descending down from heaven. Prepared just like a bride for the Son of Man. For there's a day of gladness written on his heart. For he is longing for the day that we will never be apart. When every tear will be wiped away, there'll be no sorrow, hurt, or pain. There'll be no more night. All things will be made new. It will be a brand new day. And in your righteousness you'll reign. And the Lamb will be the light. So behold, the tabernacle of God will be with men, and he will be our God, and we will be his people. And the bride, she will marry the Lamb, but until that day, I'm longing for the new Jerusalem. Oh, yeah. I long the day of your appearing. I'm gonna hasten your return. The Spirit and the bride say, come for your beloved one. How long the day of your appearing? I'm gonna hasten your return, yeah. The Spirit and the bride say, come for your beloved ones. So behold, the tabernacle of God will be with men, and he will be our God, and we will be his people. And the bride, she will marry the Lamb. But until that day, I'm longing for the new Jerusalem. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We're a bride that is not ashamed to be waiting on you. We're not ashamed to be waiting on you. We choose to be aware of you. We choose to long for you. It's an active waiting that we're in the midst of. Because as we wait, we declare. As we wait, we proclaim. As we wait, we manifest what is to come. As a sign to the earth of the fulfillment of your kingdom. It's an honor. It's a privilege. We wouldn't have it any other way. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We love you. Amen. Amen. Oh, my gosh. You guys are awesome. I asked Pastor David last night, I said, is it like this every time that you guys come together? My goodness. It says rivers just overflowing all in this place. I want to kind of recap the testimony that I shared Friday night. And I'll make it short, but as Pastor Dylan said, it's been a journey since they first saw me in West Virginia back in May. I had just finished my master's degree in theology and history at a seminary in Ohio. And I was supposed to be in West Virginia Friday. I'd finished class that Thursday. When I got home, Holy Spirit said, I want you to drive tonight. So about 9:30, I went home, kissed my wife and my babies, and hopped in the car. One of my spiritual mentors said he'd follow me down. And as I was driving down there, the Lord so clearly spoke to me and said, I'm not sending you to participate in the revival, but I'm sending you into revival. And we had this amazing exchange on the way down there. That next day, Friday, I end up preaching in the evening service to the youth pastors of the region, and Pastor David and Dylan were there. And it was a great time from what everybody else said, but I went home to the hotel that night feeling further away from God than I've ever felt in my life. It was the worst feeling that I've ever felt. I mean, I could not seem to even touch or become aware of his presence. It was horrible. And my spiritual mentor looked at me like I was crazy. And he's like, what are you talking about? The word was great. People got saved. People got ministered to. You were flowing in the prophetic, all these things. And I'm like, yeah, I get all of that. But I'm just telling you, I could not feel the Spirit of the Lord. And I knew in that moment, there wasn't anything that he could say to make me feel better. I needed to go get on my face before the Father. And so I did. And I got to the hotel and I just started crying out like, Lord, what's going on? And he spoke to me very simply. And he said, you will never be satisfied by ministry ever again. You will never be satisfied by preaching. You will never be satisfied by me moving in the prophetic through you, by me moving in signs and wonders and healing through you ever again. He said, I'm inviting you into the garden. I'm giving you a supernatural grace to pursue my presence. I had one more scheduled meeting in Cleveland, Ohio, June 4th. And he said, after you preach in Cleveland, you're not going to preach for 3 months. This is the summer of pursuit for you. Come find me in the garden. And so for the rest of June, July, and August, my mouth was shut. The only things I was allowed to participate in were prayer and worship nights that were taking place in my church. Jason Upton came to Columbus, and so I brought our young adults to his concert, and it was incredible. And there's a 24/7 house of prayer in our city called Hope for Columbus, and I was there often. But it was incredible. And I shared Friday that there was basically three gardens that the Lord had taken me through. The first one was the Garden of Eden, and he was showing me that in the Garden of Eden, there's a supernatural abundance of his presence and his provision. He was recalling me to a place of dependency and recognizing that everything I need exists in him. The second garden was as he showed me the scriptures in Song of Solomon, and it talks about the vineyard. It talks about the bride being invited to the chamber and all of these types of things. And he began to show me the intimacy that he was wanting to cultivate and really wanted me to get the revelation that I'm not just a son, but that I'm a bride and that I have a bridegroom. But the last garden was the Garden of Gethsemane, and that's the garden of the crushing. That's the garden where Dr. Mark even came and encouraged me after I spoke Friday night, where we understand that the olives were crushed in order for the anointing oil to be extracted, and all the pressure, all the crushing, the weight that took place, Jesus sweating drops of blood. And as I finished up the summer months, there was a definite crushing that came to my door. I was working two jobs last year,
Because as you know, like it was already said, you don't get into the ministry to become rich. Amen. And so I had to maintain two jobs on top of being the young adult pastor. And we were birthing our school of ministry that I'll be directing that actually starts Monday. It's called United School of Ministry. Keep us in your prayers. We got 33 students. I can't wait to get with them tomorrow. But there was just a crushing. My wife and I experienced a miscarriage on my birthday, July 25th. And again, in that place, you ask questions you've never had to ask before. And just prior to that, the Lord had used me to bring healing to a woman who had experienced two miscarriages, and the doctors had pronounced that she was going to have another one. And so I'm sitting there like, Lord, how are you going to use me to help bring healing to somebody else in this area and then, you know, let this happen to my wife and I? So there was just a lot of conversation and dialogue that was happening in this last garden where the crushing was taking place. I tried to get two other jobs when those jobs ended, and the doors just seemed to be closing left and right. I couldn't find another job, and we're still trying to figure some of those things out. But it's like when you think about the summer of pursuit and chasing him in the garden, and you've been faithful to that for these last several months, you don't think that at the end of that season, there's going to be this crazy amount of pressure. Even in relationships, I can tell you just every way you could imagine, there was just this pressing and this crushing. August 19th comes, and I felt the Lord call me to a 40-day fast. And he told me from the beginning that I would be sharing the testimony of this journey while I was in it. And I had just started reading Lou Engle's book called The Jesus Fast. And I had got to a particular chapter where he was talking about Moses and Elijah and their relationship as it pertains to fasting, how fasting is a womb. And 40 days parallels the reality of the 9-month or the 40-week pregnancy that a woman goes through, that fasting is a womb where things are birthed, where things are imparted that need to be delivered. In this particular chapter, he was talking about the relationship between one generation, Moses, passing down what was birthed through his time of fasting to the next generation, Joshua, Elijah, and Elisha. And I got to this particular part of the chapter where in the parentheses, he referenced Matthew 17. He didn't really expound on it. He didn't go into any details. It was just there in the parentheses. And so when I got done with the chapter, I read Matthew 17. If you're not aware of the chapter, it's the chapter where Jesus takes Peter, James, and John up to the Mount of Transfiguration. And who appears there with him? Moses and Elijah. Now, every time I've heard that chapter preached, I've always heard that the reason that Moses and Elijah were there was because Jesus is the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. And that makes complete sense. But there was something on the inside of me, this was Monday night, that I couldn't seem to shake as it pertains to more revelation to be discovered in the reality of why Moses, Jesus, and Elijah are standing there. So around 1 o'clock in the morning, after I've been praying and just reading the chapter and asking Holy Spirit, what is it that you're trying to show me? Very simply, he spoke to me and he said, these are the only three men in the Bible who ever did a 40-day fast. I had no idea. And I shared with him on Friday. I don't know about you, but sometimes when Holy Spirit speaks to me, I make sure that what he's saying is correct by going to Google. Anybody else done that? It's like when Holy Spirit says something, you got to make sure that he's right. So you go to Google and just double check that he didn't make a mistake. And so I go to Google and I type in who were the three men in the Bible who did a 40-day fast. And sure enough, Holy Spirit was right. Moses, Jesus, and Elijah are the only three men, at least where it's recorded, that they had experienced a 40-day fast. But then he continued to show me more. When you look at Moses and Elijah, both of them fasted in reference to Mount Sinai. Moses fasted on the mountain. Elijah fasted on his way to the mountain. You can see this in Exodus 33 and before that even. And then 1 Kings 19, their experiences. And then you think about Jesus bringing the three closest disciples of his up to Mount Transfiguration. Well, Peter would later write in his letters describing this moment that Jesus brought us to the mountain of God where he appeared in his glory. And the mountain of God is another title for Mount Sinai or Mount Horeb. So I'm convinced that the Mount of Transfiguration was Mount Sinai. And even if it's not, I'm going to believe that it is because it's just cooler if it is. And so I started to just consider, okay, you've got these three men, the only three men who have done a 40-day fast, meeting at this same mountain. Lord, what are you trying to show me? And there was three things that he showed me that are consistent in each one of these experiences. The voice of God is heard. Moses has given the law. He's given a description of the nature and the character of God, his goodness, his mercy that endures to 1,000 generations and so on. Elijah, when he's on the mountain, the Bible says that the Lord speaks to him, and it wasn't through the fire, the wind, or the earthquake, but it was through the still small voice. Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration, the heavens open up just like when he was baptized, and the Father says, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to everything that he commands you." So we see the voice of God every single time there's one of these mountain experiences. But then the other thing that we see again is the revelation of who God is. There was a greater understanding of the nature and the character of God. Again, Moses was given a direct understanding. Elijah, I believe even in the process of the Lord not being in the wind, the Lord not being in the earthquake or the fire, was God trying to communicate, "This is who I am." What's really interesting about both of these particular men is that they had just came from experiencing great, mighty, powerful experiences. Moses and the plagues and the miracles that took place as he delivered the children of Egypt, delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt. Elijah had just been on Mount Carmel where he had called fire down from heaven. But yet it's in this intimate space when they're alone with God that I believe the greatest revelation and the greatest strategy for their ministries and for their purpose actually came. When you think about even Elijah, he's standing there, and the Bible says that he had to cover his face. I believe that's because the glory of God was so bright. So that's the third thing that we see on the mountain. We have the voice of God, the revelation of God's nature, his character, his person, and then you have the glory of God. Again, Moses comes down from the mountain, and then the children of Israel tell him to cover himself because he's so bright. Elijah has to cover his face because the brightness of the Lord. And then we get to the Mount of Transfiguration. Not only is the face of Jesus shining, but his clothes. And if that wasn't enough, if you continue reading in Matthew 17, you get to this particular point where the episode shifts, the scene shifts. Jesus and the three disciples come down and they meet the other disciples who are at the bottom. And they're dealing with a father who has a son who was demon possessed. And they were not able to cast the demon out. And they ask Jesus why. And he goes into this small teaching about faith. And he says that if you have a faith the size of a mustard seed, you'll be able to tell this mountain to go from here to there. And he continues and he makes this statement that we've heard many times. This kind only comes by prayer and fasting. And again, a lot of times when I've heard that particular passage of scripture preached, it's always been kind of spoken in such a way where it's almost like they're saying this grade of demon will only come out by prayer and fasting, or this type of strength when it comes to the miracles and when it comes to all of these things only comes by prayer and fasting. But that's not really what Jesus was talking about. What he was saying is this type of faith only comes by prayer and fasting. So then it really all made sense of why he had this moment on the top of Mount Transfiguration with the only two other men who had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. So he's teaching his disciples, if you do this, you will walk away with this type of faith. He makes it so simple. If you pray and fast, you will obtain great faith. So after I got done having this moment with the Lord, he said to me very simply, your season of being in the garden is over. I'm taking you from the garden to the mountain. I'm taking you from the garden to the mountain, from my presence to my glory. And it made so much sense why he had asked me to start the fast now, right? So I'm freaking out already. I knew that the first day that I was going to preach again since June 4th was going to be during this meeting. September 9th. And so I had been looking forward to it and praying into it and just still perplexed as to why I was even invited. As you probably heard, they didn't even know where I was from. Some people thought I was from West Virginia. Dylan thought I was from Tennessee. You know, all they saw me was for that one night in the West Virginia revival meeting, and that was it. And so I get here, and oh my goodness, I get on this property, and I'm surrounded by mountains, and so I'm freaking out just on that alone. And then I hear about the Moravian, you know, history here. Well, in the beginning of the summer, right when I started that season of pursuit, I have a friend, his name is Carl Madison, who invited me to participate in what's called the Moravian Watch, where we would pray Tuesday nights from 1 a.m. to 2 a.m. And I had no idea that I was coming to the very place that Moravian refugees came to on the other side of their 100-year prayer revival. I mean, you just can't make this stuff up. If that wasn't enough, I have to tell you this. We have, my wife and I have really good friends in Northern Ohio. And my wife had gotten a prophetic word for the pastor and his wife that their ministry was going to be shifting to Columbus, where we live. And my wife is just kind of moving into, you know, the reality of what she's called to as a prophetess. And, you know, it was one of those times where I was like, you know, babe, I can't speak what God told you. He didn't tell me that. You need to call them and reach out to them and relay this word to them. Well, she did. And that particular week, Bonnie Jones just happened to be in Columbus. She felt led of the Spirit to go to Columbus, minister throughout the churches in the area, but specifically had a vision of Pastor Mark and knew that she had to go to his church. And one of the prophetic words that she delivered to him was that his ministry was shifting to Columbus. I was on my way here Friday and talking to my wife, who had just cut Pastor Mark's wife's hair. And they were just sharing about what had happened. And what was crazy is not only did my wife and Bonnie Jones give the word, but Diane had a dream about them coming to Columbus. So it's just being confirmed in all of these ways. My wife is encouraged, right? Because she's getting the confirmation that she did hear the voice of the Lord. What happens when I get here? Dylan, he shows me the church. And then he says, hey, by the way, Bob Jones is buried out there. Do you want to go see his grave? I'm like, you gotta be kidding me. And I'm just losing it. And if all of that wasn't enough, in this 40-day fast, there was a 20-day split. The Lord called me to eat one meal a day for the first 20 days in the evening, about when the sun would go down. And then he said for the second 20 days, water only. The second 20 days started September 9th, my first day here. So I wanted to bring you into my world for a second. I told him Friday night, it was hard for me to even stand up most of the day because of all of these things. And I really believe that I came here just as much for me, if not more for me, than for you all. And the things that God has shared with me, the prophetic words that I've received since I've been here have been incredible. And so thank you. It's truly been a blessing. So Friday night, I spoke to the youth and young adults, and we talked about a Joshua generation rising up, and that God was looking to raise up a generation who would get their own. In other words, even though he parted the Jordan River to show that Joshua was going to have the same authority and the same power as Moses, he did it differently. And so this generation might move in similar ways as the prior generation, but the methods are going to be different. Moses had a staff. Joshua had the Ark of the Covenant. And so the Lord spoke to the youth and was telling them to be aware that God is looking to do a new thing, and that he's raising up a Joshua generation who will understand how to fight from the presence of God and the rest of God. Looking in Joshua chapter 6, we saw that there was about 7 or 8 realities of how the children of Israel dealt with the presence. They announced the presence by blowing trumpets. They guarded the presence with priests in front and behind. The Bible says that during that battle that they rested in the presence. They woke up to the presence. They let the presence speak for them. And the Lord was encouraging us that we don't need to defend ourselves as a kingdom of priests in the earth, making way for the return of the Lord. But the very presence of God will talk for us. And we talked about how after 7 days of obeying the Lord,
in silence, letting the presence speak for itself, there was a trail that was blazed so that in the appointed time when the Lord would say, shout, the presence had added a weight and added power to their voice that caused the walls to fall. This ultimately leading them into the rest, the promised land that they had been promised. But we know that it was not Joshua ultimately that fulfilled the true reality of rest and promise that was given to Abraham. It was Jesus who did that. Hebrews 4 talks about that. So we went through all of that. And then last night, the Lord had a word out of Revelation chapter 2, where Jesus is addressing the church of Thyatira. And he talks about the reality that he understands their works and their love and their patience and their faith and all of these great things that they were doing. But there was one thing that he had against them. And it was the reality that they were tolerating the spirit of Jezebel in the form of idolatry and sexual immorality. And the Lord spoke and he said that there's a generation that is rising up in the earth that will not forfeit the authority that they've been given over the nations for false idols and temporary pleasures that come from sexual immorality. And so last night we pressed into that thing and it was powerful. And God reminded the young people of the inheritance that they have been given as co-heirs with Jesus Christ, sons and daughters of the living God. That just as Jesus, the Lord is saying, ask of me and I will give you the nations for your inheritance and the ends of the earth for your possession. But the Lord has been very practical over these last couple of days. He talked about the young people starting to walk around their schools and walk around their communities, letting the presence go before them, beginning to address the principalities and beginning to address these demonic forces that are at work among them and their friends and their families and their community. He talked about how the night is going to be a place through which God is going to release great power, where we're going to see the greatest harvest during this awakening in the night. When the devil thinks he's getting something off, but they're sons and daughters of God who have committed themselves to prayer and fasting and worship in the night watch. Where out of the bars and out of the strip clubs and homeless communities in the night are going to get rocked, healed, delivered, saved, and set free. There was a practical word giving. Stop letting Facebook and Instagram take your night. Stop letting social media make you a zombie in the night where we spend 2-3 hours scrolling and scrolling and scrolling till we fall asleep. And use that time to intercede and go to war in the spirit as we come into agreement with the kingdom of God and what he's wanting to release in this day. I mean, he was being practical with us. So that's where we've been. But I feel my spirit this morning. The Lord wants to end my time here with just drawing our minds and our hearts to just kind of that bigger picture reality that God has a plan. He has a purpose and he's committed to it. He says in Hebrews that he has sworn by his name and his word two immutable things that cannot be changed. Even when he established the covenant with Abraham that we are now being partakers of. You can read this in Genesis 15. He had Abraham fall asleep when he sacrificed the animals and split them in two as the blood walked in the center. It was only the pillar of fire and the cloud of smoke that passed through. What that represented was God was making the covenant with himself. There was nothing that man could add to it. There was nothing that we could bring to the table of equal value. God says, I'm making this promise on who I am and my faithfulness. You're just a beneficiary of it. So just come into agreement with it. And so I believe the Lord is saying to us this morning, what will happen when we become convinced of his purpose in everyday life? I mean, completely convinced. You know, it's one of those things that as a young adult pastor, I get asked a lot of the tough questions. You know, I think in youth and middle school, they're still kind of, they'll just kind of believe what you tell them, especially if you're quoting scripture, you know. And there's an advantage to that sometimes, right? You know, they don't ask as many questions. But young adults, if they're coming to church, it's because they want to. Their parents aren't driving them anymore. I don't pass out lollipops and ice cream. You know, as a young adult pastor, I don't got time for that. So if they're there, it's because they are actually pursuing the Lord. But they ask a lot of tough questions. Keeps me on my toes. And just recently, I had a young adult ask me, why all of these hundreds and thousands of years? Why didn't God just fix it right there in the garden, move on with what he knew he wanted to do anyways? And I pondered that. And I just began to meditate on the question alone. And all I could come up with was two things. Number one, God has proven that he is a God that is obsessed with partnership. He had Adam name the animals. He had Noah build the ark. He had Abraham birth the nation. He had Moses deliver the children of Israel. He had David build the temple. Jesus ministered for 3 years and then passed it on to the disciples. We serve a God who is obsessed with partnership. Whatever he does in the earth, he wants us to be a part of it. He wants us to participate in it. He loves it. And he would have it no other way. But the other thing is that over the course of these hundreds and thousands of years, there's been revelation after revelation after revelation of who he is. And as the Bible says in Habakkuk 2 verse 14, that this is his ultimate desire, that the earth would be filled with the glory of the knowledge of God as the waters cover the sea. How is he doing that? Through us. The Bible says in Ephesians that the manifold wisdom of God is being made known to the principalities and the powers as they watch it revealed through the church. So that means angels are up in heaven saying, oh my goodness, that's who God is. Oh my goodness, that's what God is doing as they watch us respond to his goodness. It's incredible. It makes you understand why the psalmist asked the question, what is man? Who are these human beings that you are so mindful of them, that you have crowned them with glory and honor? It's incredible. We play a big role in this thing. So I just want to take a second and read some scripture over you. I say this from the Spirit. I know who I'm talking to. I said this last night, that I'm in the midst of a people who have great faith and great belief. But the Lord is transitioning your faith and belief into a process of becoming what you believe and have faith in. Let me say that again. He's shifting you from a people who just have great faith and great belief into a process where you are now becoming the very things you have faith and belief in. So let's just go through some of these. Revelation 21, 1 through 8, I sang most of that. So let's go to the next section. Verse 22, it says, but I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light. And the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light, and the kings of the earth bring their glory and honor into it. Its gates shall not be shut at all by day. There shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and the honor of the nations into it. But there shall by no means enter anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the middle of its street and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were the healing of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. They shall see his face. And his name shall be on their foreheads. There shall be no night there. He says that three times. They need no lamp nor light of the sun, for the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. Hallelujah. Go to Isaiah 65, verse 17. I'm just going to read some word over you. For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth. And the former shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem as a rejoicing and her people a joy. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and joy in my people. The voice of weeping shall no longer be heard in her, nor the voice of crying. No more shall an infant from their life but a few days. No more shall an infant live but for a few days, nor an old man who has not fulfilled his days. For the child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree, so shall be the days of my people. And my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth children for trouble. For they shall be the descendants of the blessed of the Lord, and their offspring with them. Go to Isaiah 11. The Bible says, there shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight is in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek. He's going to make all things right. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of his waist. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the young goat. The calf and the young lion and the fatling together. And a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hole, and the weaned child shall put his hand in the viper's den. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Go to Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 7. Verse 13. I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed. Hallelujah forever. Go to Hosea. Yeah. Amen, Lord. Amen. Verse 12. Sow yourselves righteousness, reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he comes and rains righteousness on you. Hallelujah. Micah chapter 4, verse 3. He shall judge between many peoples and rebuke strong nations afar off. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. But everyone shall sit under his vine and under his fig tree, and no one shall make them afraid. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. For all people walk each in the name of his God, but we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever. Just a few more. Amen. Haggai chapter 2, verse 5. According to the word that I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, so my spirit remains among you. Do not fear. For thus says the Lord of hosts, once more, it is a little while, I will shake heaven and earth, the sea and dry land, and I will shake all nations, but they shall come to the desire of all nations. And I will fill this temple with glory, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine and the gold is mine. Jesus. The glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, says the Lord of hosts. Amen. Thank you, Lord. What's he trying to say to us? He's looking for people who are convinced that everything that has been written, every detail of the promise will be fulfilled. I said this last night, that the prayers that we pray for Jerusalem, we need to understand Jerusalem is the holy city of God. But God's desire for Jerusalem mirrors his desire for the earth. That what he manifests in Jerusalem would be manifest everywhere. You know, I read this in Zechariah chapter 8. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I am zealous for Zion with great zeal, with great fervor. I am zealous for her. Thus says the Lord, I will return to Zion and dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. Jerusalem shall be called the city of truth, the mountain of the Lord of hosts, the holy mountain. Thus says the Lord of hosts, old men and old women shall again sit in the streets of Jerusalem, each one with his staff in his hand because of great age. The streets of the city shall be full of boys and girls playing in the streets. The Lord just wanted us to get these pictures fresh in our mind. I know there's many, many intercessors in this place. And that every once in a while, we just need to be reminded of what it is that we're fighting for. Go to Isaiah 61. This is his plan. How is he going to do all of this? How has he been doing all of this? Well, it's right here. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. That's his strategy. We know that Jesus is the branch, but out of the branch, many seeds were sown through his blood and his resurrection. And he prayed a prayer in John 17, not just for the disciples that were among him, but all of those that would come after him. That's us. That we would complete everything that he had for us. We are those trees of righteousness that are sprouting up. Little Christians, little Christs, little Jesuses. There's a law when it comes to planting. A seed can only reproduce after its own kind. Genesis 1 through 3 teaches us this. Jesus was a seed that went into the earth for 3 days. And when he sprung forth, every seed that would come after him has to represent him. And so if he came with a ministry of reconciliation and healing, if he came with a message of hope, if he came with a message of the gospel of the kingdom, by which people becoming free who are bound, people becoming free who are captive. That's our message. That's our strategy. It's fascinating to me. There's this shift that is happening. And I believe right here, the Lord is just impressing this on me. We are going to become what we believe. We are going to become what we have faith in. This whole process of saying yes to the invitation of salvation is a process of transformation. It's a process of becoming something. That's why the Bible says in John chapter 1, verse 12, I believe, that he came to his own and his own received him not, but to those who did receive him, to them was given power. What? To become the sons of God, to those who believe in his name. So we receive, we believe in order to become. The Bible says in Romans chapter 1, 16 and 17, it's a verse that many of us know. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it's the power to God unto salvation, first for the Jew and also for the Greek. That's a verse that's quoted quite often. But it's the next verse that really grabs me. Paul goes on to say in verse 17 that in it the righteousness of God has been revealed from faith to faith, just as the just shall live by faith. What's he saying? When you look at that word righteousness in the Greek, it's a Greek word, dikaiosune. And a part of the root definition of that word is simply this: as a man ought to be. So what is righteousness? Righteousness are human beings that through the blood of Jesus Christ and the resurrection and his ascension, that we see him for who he is, we are transformed, and we become everything that God intended us to be in the garden. Paul would go on to write in Romans chapter 5 that through one man sin entered into the earth, Adam, but through the resurrection of Jesus, eternal life. Everything that was lost in the garden has been restored. Everything. And it starts with us. And so this whole process of being convinced of God's purpose, of being convinced of God's dream, we've got to recognize that it's God who intended to make man in his own image. It's God who saw fit to make us kings and priests in the earth, walking in dominion over everything that he created. And the imagination and the creativity and the beauty of God, he created all of this. But in his wisdom, he said, I want to give it to you. I want you to steward it for me. I want you to walk over it. I want you to have dominion over it all. One of the things we shared last night was in that episode with Adam and Eve in the garden, we see that there were two trees, not one. There was a tree of life and there was the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And we know which one Eve ate from. But in Genesis chapter 3, God makes this statement to the angel, we have to kick them out of the garden, because if they now eat from the tree of life in this current condition, they will live like this for eternity. So I said it last night and I'll say it again. Death is a gift. That's a whole other message for another day. But this is the thing that caught my mind. He's talking about the fruit that was on the tree of life. So Eve could have chose to eat of the tree of life first and not the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, what would have happened if Eve had a greater appetite for life than she had for knowledge? What would have happened if she had a greater appetite for life than she had for knowledge? But then he turned the question right to me. He said, what will happen through your life, through the life of the bride, through the life of the church, if we begin to have a greater appetite for life than we have an appetite for knowledge? What will happen? You see, it's again in this garden that we understand the limitless nature of God. The abundance of God, everything that we could ever need, that's life. And I'll say this as a disclaimer. If you think I'm against knowledge, if you think that I'm against learning and growing and understanding, you're not hearing me. That knowledge should never restrict our understanding of who God is, though. That knowledge should never make us think any less of God. If you go to seminary, if you study the word, if you understand church history and understand theology, the result, if it's by the Spirit, should ultimately make you step back and say, whoa, who is this God that I serve? He is amazing. So God is looking for a people who have a greater appetite for life than knowledge. But going back to this scripture in Romans, this process of becoming, For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it's the power of, to God unto salvation for the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it the revelation of righteousness has been revealed. That means that within the gospel, all the revelation that we need to become what God intended us to be exists. That when we share the gospel with people, we are actually drawing and inviting them back into the created order of God and what his dream, what his idea for humanity actually was. You see, Jesus did not just come to reveal to us who God is. That was a huge part. But he also came to show us what a human being looks like that is entirely devoted, submitted, and in love with the Father. What does that actually look like played out on the earth? And upon the resurrection, we have been invited to live that way now. We're allowed to. One of the songs that I sang from prayer has this line that says, "You went in before us so we can go in too." And because of his blood, we can let go of the shame and the guilt and the condemnation and the accusation of the enemy. And we can walk into the fullness of who we've been called to be as sons and daughters of God. Listen, your being is the source of your doing. In other words, it's only when we become righteous that we will live righteously. The church has had it backwards for a lot of years. It's only when we become love that we will love. It's only when we become peace that we will live peacefully. It's only when we become holy that we will live holiness. You hearing me? This is his way. And as sons and daughters walk into this revelation and start to embody it, creation itself is getting an understanding about what's about to happen to it. If you want to know God's plan for creation, look at what he does in a person's life who fully gives themselves to the gospel of the kingdom. Whatever we read in the Bible about what God is ultimately going to do to the earth, we need to understand that within that is a part of our assignment. Because he will not do it to the earth until he first does it to the bride. So if his ultimate plan is for the knowledge of the glory of the Lord to cover the earth as the waters cover the sea, then we should be sons and daughters crying out, "Let the knowledge of your glory cover me as the waters cover the sea." The very reality of what he is going to do in and on and to the earth is first seen and manifested and done in us. That's why the Bible says in Romans chapter 8 that creation itself is groaning and crying out for the revealing of the sons of God. Because the earth understands that its very destiny is hinged upon our acceptance and our transformation and our becoming everything that God intended us to become. The trees are looking at us. The mountains are looking at us. The oceans are looking at us. The animal kingdom is looking at us and saying, "Would you humans get it together and accept the grace of the living God so we can have some fun too?" That's what creation is crying out. But that will only come through a people who are convinced that this is God's way. It's his dream to do it like this. If any one of us were God, we probably would have done it a lot easier, quicker way. But it shows how, again, obsessed he is with partnership and participation and bringing us into the mix. So what does this look like in real life? It looks like a people who every single day, living from the place of the affirmation of his love, living from the place of victory, living from the place of the triumph, living from the place of our inheritance, go into the world with a mission to make him known through how we live because of who we are. Now, let me say that again. We wake up every single day going into the earth, wherever we are, in our schools, in our work, every sphere of influence, entertainment, government, all of it. And God is going to strategically place, he has been throughout all the age, strategically placing sons and daughters who don't just believe in him, don't just have faith in him, but have become what they believe and have faith in enough. To where the earth looks at them and says, "That's what God's up to. I want to be a part of that."
That's his heart. We were created to ooze his presence and his glory, to be a reflection of all that he is. And it's contagious. There's times where I've just been walking in the coffee shop and somebody will stop me. I don't know you. I don't know anything about you, but there's just something about you. Can we talk? I had a young man. He's from India. His parents are from India. And he was struggling with his idea of religion and faith. And he just sat down next to me in the Starbucks and said, I know this is weird, but I just feel like I can ask you some questions. And we began to read the scriptures together. And now he's back as a committed Christian, and he's trying to read the whole Bible this year. We're reading other books together. It's just amazing. You know, you walk into a Tim Hortons, and you know the lady behind the counter, you can just tell she's not having the greatest of day. But you recognize, God, you didn't bring me to this Tim Hortons just for me. But maybe there's something you want to do here. And she asks you for your order, and before you even respond, you say, are you all right? She tries to play it off. Yeah, I'm fine. No. Are you okay? Well, actually, I'm going through a lot of pain right now. All right, well, when you're done taking my order, come over here. I want to pray for you. 60-year-old woman has had chronic hip pain for years. It was actually pretty funny. The Lord told me to take my knit hat. It was in the winter, and give it to her and have her put it on wherever the pain was. He said, don't touch her. I prayed for 15 seconds. I look up, and her eyes are just so big. I come back a few weeks later, and I ask her, how are you? She's like, are you kidding me? And this 60-plus-year-old woman does a toe touch. But this stuff is normal, and I know you guys know this. But I guess my heart and what I believe the Father was just wanting me to end my time with over these last 3 days is really just that declaration of this shift that's happened in the body of Christ. We are going to become what we say we believe and what we have faith in. And it's going to rock the nations. It really is. And I hear the heart of the Lord, and he's so excited. He's so excited. I feel like we're entering into a space that he has just been waiting for. And he says to us, it was worth every single transition, every single unfolding. I wouldn't change any of it. Because it's literally all of the prayers, all of the revelation of those who came before us, all of the prophetic words that were downloaded and great giants of the faith going back hundreds and hundreds of years that have been the culmination of where we stand right now. I said to the young people last night that within any generation, there should always be two things happening. We should be stewarding the assignments, the prophetic words, the intercessions of the previous generation as we're birthing a new thing. Those two things should always be happening, this dynamic of stewarding and birthing. But again, I just believe that the Father is so excited. I mean, he is just so pumped for what's right around the corner. And he's sitting down looking at us, and he's like, they're getting it. They're getting it. They're understanding what has literally been a mystery. I love that it's mysterious. A God that I can completely wrap my mind around is too small for me. If I can figure it out by this many years of school or by this many hours of study, if there was a formula that could be given, if you read your Bible for a year straight, 18 hours a day, and you accomplish at least 10 years of, you know, higher education theology work, then you're going to completely understand everything about God. That would destroy intimacy. That would destroy dependency upon a spirit. Holy Spirit is the one who reveals and guides and leads us into all truth, primarily the revelation of Jesus. So I'm just excited. I am. Yeah, I feel like he's done. Why don't you go ahead and stand? I feel like he's done, at least with preaching. Yeah, you can definitely come play. It was really interesting last night. I shared this
before I started preaching, and I talked about how there's this place that we're entering into where the Lord is going to communicate from heaven through sound waves. And he's going to start communicating to us through music and through being still in his presence, where there's no words, but just the rhythm and the patterns of the music are speaking to us, the sounds and the realities of heaven. And my sister, what's your name? Christine. After the service, she sat down over here next to me, and she was in Detroit earlier this year, and she was sleeping in a bunk bed, and she looked up, and the Lord told her to take a picture of the springs of the bunk bed, and told her that represents the frequencies that the Lord is wanting to start communicating to us through, that when we come into a land, when we come into a body, that we can become one with those frequencies of heaven over that area. So that was crazy confirmation, but I just want to enter into a time like that, and then we'll just see what the Lord wants to do. I just want Joshua and the team to just begin to play. This is all right. And I want us to just still our hearts. And again, as we enter into this space, this is really the word of the day. Will we be a people who are convinced of his kingdom, of his purpose, to the point that we become what we believe and have faith in? So just take that before the Lord.